Hello, everyone. My name is Kathy Dornbush, and I am an MFA from January 2012. My talk today is going to be directed to emerging writers who are just entering the publishing business in terms of literary journals, LitMag. So when I received my master's, I went off and finished my novel. I had three short stories that I was told by instructors here on the island, publishable, and I knew that I was going to have to try to pursue that, but I put it off. And it was a nagging thing. When am I going to start? Well, I dove in at the AWP conference in Boston. And if you haven't been to an AWP conference and gone into the big exhibition hall, then you don't know necessarily what a large field this is. And you go from booth to booth and pick up journals, talk to editors, and so forth. Since that time, I have submitted 150 short story submissions. Now, in the interest of building narrative tension into my talk, I'm not going to tell you whether or not I was successful until later in the presentation. So I followed a very traditional route. I decided that with my first story, I wanted to have it in print form. So I was looking at print journals. It's called a beginner's need to have something tangible. Mm-hmm. Also, in terms of reputation, I decided that the pushcart prize was a good barometer. If a journal nominates for the pushcart or has pushcart winners, that would be a good place to submit. And for those of you who don't know about the pushcart, it was one of those phrases that was out there. I didn't really understand it entirely. Started in the 70s by a group of writers who wanted to celebrate small presses and independent publishers. And each year, about 20 pushcarts are awarded for fiction. There are also pushcarts for other genres as well. And it's the anthology that they put together is called by the pushcart people, the most honored literary series in America. And I believe on that little bibliography that I handed out, you'll see Clifford Garstang does a annual poll of pushcart, which you may be familiar with. And he actually shows you the journals and how many, over a rolling 10-year basis, how many have been able to have winners in the pushcart series. So for 2014, the top journals for the pushcart are Plowshares, Conjunctions, Tin House, Southern Review, One Story, Paris Review, A Public Space, Three Penny Review, Kenyon Review. Now, from my perspective and going through this process a little bit, I'd just like to make a few observations. One is that the literary magazine world is a closed economy. And with an economist husband, I said, you know, help me with this terminology a little bit. But a closed economy in that most of the readers of Lit Mags are writers. And then you also have this tiny, you know, a lot of the journals are based in academia. They're housed in universities and colleges. And so you have a situation where literary journals exist to help people get published outside of mainstream publishing. It's a venue of sorts. But that close relationship between editor, you know, the product, the literary mag, the producers, the editors and the writers, and then the consumers, the readers, it's all sort of, one person could have all three roles, right? And so it leads to a very small, insular kind of community in a lot of ways. So the end result is that money's tight, payments are low, and subscriptions, contests, and institutional support become necessary to keep a lot of these journals alive. Most are run on shoestring budgets. The usual circulation is about 1,000 to 2,000 subscribers. And as those of us who have gone through the process know, usually you're paid in copies. Or maybe if you're lucky, they'll throw a subscription in. And that So in other words, remember that a lot of these journals are, for those of us who are new to this, remember that a lot of these are college and university affiliated. They're using the infrastructure of the institutions to stay alive. There are exceptions to this. There are for-profit independent lit mags, and most of us are aware of Glimmer Train being one of them. They accept general submissions, but also run annual ongoing contests. There's Tin House, Granta, and Zoetrope. Now, there are also a number of nonprofit independent presses, including One Story. McSweeney's just recently became a nonprofit. The Sun Magazine, Boston Review, and Narrative Magazine. Narrative Magazine allowing or having all free content. The for-profit and nonprofit journals are the ones that have larger circulations, some of them in the 10 to 60,000 range. Glimmer Train says that they have 16,000 paid subscribers. The Sun Magazine boasts 70,000 subscribers. And Narrative Magazine, which is again free and online content, is read by people all around the world. In terms of payment, there's more likely a payment from these independent presses. For example, Narrative Magazine has up to $1,000. It might even be more now for longer manuscripts. And Glimmer Train, through its various contests, distributes about $50,000 a year to writers. But through all this, I guess my point is that the struggling nature of this business, and I just want to point out a few indicators of where things are in this. The Connecticut Review, which was published by the Connecticut State University System beginning in the mid-60s, in terms of their situation, it's not good, because I went on their website, and maybe someone has more information about this, but as of the spring of 2013, they are on hiatus. And they have a beautiful website, and there's no way to submit there. In 2011, Shenandoah, which is Washington and Lee University's literary review, for its 61st anniversary issue, they went to all online content, and it's free. And that seems to be a harbinger of the fate that many of these print literary journals are facing right now. The paradox is that the internet has brought more literary magazines out and has created more venues for writers, but there's that whole situation of how well accepted are online journals, like Mason's Road. There are some people on the internet who say that one of the reasons why Shenandoah has fewer pushcart nominations now is because people might resent the fact that they've gone online. And lastly, you know, a lot of journals are doing both, print and online. They might alternate issues, or they might be an online press that puts together an annual printed anthology. So even with the costs of publishing and the problem in reaching readers who are not themselves writers, there are more literary magazines than ever. And I've included in that bibliography that's floating around here, and there are some other, if you need one, there are others. What I started with was this, Little Magazines, the International Directory of Little Magazines and Small Presses. It's in its 50th edition now, and it boasts 4,000 book and magazine publishers. And I just walked my way through, and it's indexed according to subject and so forth. And I just spent days going through here, reading each of the entries, and coming up with a list that I thought would be helpful, productive. The other thing, Poets and Writers has an online source as well, but there are 800 literary magazines in their collection, but the biggest by far is Duotrope, which many of you may know, an online database of about 5,000 markets in fiction, poetry, and nonfiction. And I think it was a couple years ago, they went from free to $50 subscription. But it is by far the biggest, and it has other really valuable things to offer as well, which we'll touch on a little later. I also just included a few other guides to literary magazines. There's a lot on the internet if you start looking around and linking from piece to piece. And it's interesting that with so many markets, the journals themselves are trying to find a little niche. So there are certain specific things that they're trying to do to make themselves stand out. There is, for example, Everyday Fiction, if you might be familiar with that, an online journal that publishes a new short piece of fiction every 24 hours at midnight. There's One Story, which I have here's my One Story here. It's run out of Brooklyn and Portland, and every 3 weeks they produce One Story. I opted for the pamphlet version, but they also have a Kindle version and some other online sources for that. And then there's, for example, The First Line, a print and electronic journal that offers the first line, and writers are to build on that. So currently, their first line that they're asking for submissions to is, "We went as far as the car could take us." And everyone would write off of that. Hmm. Now, in terms of the review process and the emerging writer, and I'd love to hear other people's view on this, as a newbie going out there, I'm wondering how the submission process really works when most places do not use blind submissions. Hats off to Mason's Road for using the blind submission process. It seems like few journals take that course. Most allow biographical information on their submission pages. Many require that the author's name appear on every page of the submission that you tack on to into the file. And so it just seems to me that if Joyce Carol Oates sends a story to a journal, it's gonna get a lot different reaction in the editorial office than someone they've never heard of. And yet, most journals promise that they will consider emerging artists. Now, in terms of response times and simultaneous submissions, and there's a lot of disparity in opinion on this. If a journal says they don't take more, they don't want you to send the piece out to another journal until they're finished reviewing it, I know a lot of people who ignore that. I haven't, so it'll be interesting to hear from other people on this. But one of the things I've figured out is if a journal has a long response time, and that's one of those things that Duotrope will provide you, that online service, if they have a long response time and they have a very low acceptance rate, also a figure that's available on Duotrope, and they prohibit simultaneous submissions, then where does that leave you? I've had journals hold on to my stories for a year. And I don't think it seems a little heartless, but that's the way it is. There are contests as vehicles to getting published. In addition to Glimmer Train, a lot of these little journals are using contests as a way of fundraising. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes the winners will be published in a special issue. In terms of finding a good fit, that's kind of, in terms of your writing, that's sort of beyond the scope of what I'd like to talk about. Although I will say that looking at journals is important and getting a feel for them. And I have brought a number of copies here that you can leaf through after the presentation today. And if you're interested in taking any of them, please let me know, because I think that would be fine. Now, in terms of making the submissions online, nearly all journals want their submissions to be done online now. There are some, like Gettysburg Review is one of the few that still wants the old-fashioned paper, but most of them want you to submit online, and they require a small fee of $2 to $3. And I don't like using credit cards online in general. So what I found is that a gift card, MasterCard, Visa, works just fine for paying that fee. Most of the journals are now paying Submittable, which is a company, to manage their submissions. And the neat thing about Submittable is that you create a password-sensitive account with all your contact information. And so let's say I'm submitting to one story, although they don't, I don't think they use, I think they might have their own submission managers, as I recall. But if you, if a journal takes submittable, then all I have to do is click into that, and it serves as a conduit, brings up all my information, and then I can put my cover letter and paste my story to the site and submit. Very easy. And then it offers you a list that you can go back and check. So you can see what's been sent through submittable. It's another way of keeping track of your submissions. But what about submission trackers in general? If you've got dozens of stories out there, how do you keep them all straight? Well, Duotrope is one of those services. One of their services is a submission tracker. You have to report your information to them. And they actually use, as soon as your piece is either rejected or accepted, and you let them know, then they use that data to come up with their statistics. So they have quite a few. I don't know the exact number of subscribers that Duotrope has, but it's pretty high. I decided not to do that. I began with Duotrope, and then I decided to do it myself. Because if you're only going to use Duotrope for submission tracking, you don't really need them. You can do it on your own. You can use an Excel spreadsheet. Some people do that. I came up with my own, and I actually put this on your handout, the things that I was interested in. You know, when is the reading period? What kind of journal is it? Is it a nonprofit, profit? What kind of things do they like to publish? In this case, one story, the pushcart number there refers to that index that I was telling you about. They've been very successful in getting pushcart winners through one story. It gives you the word count, word limits, how you submit online, submissions manager, whether there's a fee. I like to keep that in mind. Multiple submissions. Very rarely will a journal take more than one piece at a time. The reporting time, simultaneous submissions, yes, the circulation. And then at the bottom, I will put down what I've submitted, the date, and then when I get word back from them, that will go at the bottom of each of these entries. And it's worked out really well because I can keep it as a big document. I keep it in one document, and then I can search it and change things and sort of maintain my focus that way. All right, what about acceptance rates? They're insanely small. Some journals, especially the economically viable commercial ones, receive tens of thousands of submissions a year. They say it's easier to get into Harvard than it is to get published in Glimmer Train. 40,000 submissions a year, and they publish 40 short stories. And again, Duotrope is a good source for that kind of information. Now, what about rejection letters? Well, the good, the bad, and the indifferent. Here's an indifferent one. And I don't know why, but when you do a paper submission and ask for the, you know, self-addressed envelope and you get this back, these are among the worst. This is Carolina, the Carolina Quarterly. Thank you for your interest in the Carolina Quarterly. We regret to inform you that we cannot place your work at this time. At least with the online submissions, the title of your piece will appear somewhere. Mm-hmm. It makes me feel a little bit better. Mm-hmm. But I just want to read this funny essay. This is how to interpret your rejection letters, and it's just a little excerpt from Seth, is it Fried or Freed? Was published in Tin House in 2013, and he did a very comical piece on deciphering the editorial responses to a piece. And this one is how to interpret a response on a lukewarm response. The response being, thank you for your submission. We regret that we are unable to publish it, but we appreciate your interest in name of journal. He suggests you interpret the letter as follows. Try to imagine a giraffe on roller skates, slowly rolling toward the edge of a cliff. The giraffe has been drinking, and maybe as it's rolling toward the edge, it's even wearing one of those beer helmets with two cans of Budweiser in it and straws leading down to the giraffe's mouth. The giraffe hiccups once or twice and then plummets to a senseless, idiotic death. The reason you should try to keep this image of the giraffe in your head is because it is a perfect metaphor for what has just happened to your submission. Your writing is the giraffe. The cliff is the journal that you sent it to, and the giraffe's beer helmet is every nice thing your mother has ever said about you. So why bother submitting to literary journals when the odds are stacked against us? Well, personal satisfaction. A lot of times professionally, it has to be done. You have to create that, the leg of the stool that Michael was talking about earlier, MFA, publications, and teaching, if you want to go into a teaching field. So how did I do on my submissions? Sadly, I didn't place anything yet. But along the way, I have received some encouraging words. And here's one of my favorite responses. This is from one story, and it's the submission that I put on that little blurb on your handout. It was for my story Sugar Moon, which I wrote for Karen Osborne's class, in which she encouraged that I send out there into the world. It's a tough piece to place. It's historical fiction. A lot of places don't want to consider that. And it also has a strong Christian content because it is about a New England setting in the 1800s. And so it's been tough out there. But this is the response I got from the editors of one story. Thank you for sending us Sugar Moon. Unfortunately, this particular piece was not a right fit for one story, but we were very impressed by your writing. We hope that you will feel encouraged by this short note and send us something else.
Yay!
We look forward to reading more. Sincerely, the editors. So I guess over the course of the year, a couple years since I graduated, I am developing a skin as thick as a pineapple rind, and I will continue with this journey. I am going to renew my subscription to Duotrope and use their searchable engine to really go out there and find new places where I can submit my work. So thanks.
Hi, I'm Jillian, and I graduated in July 13, and I will say I'm here because Kathy and her Duotrope idea saved my life. So I'm going to talk to you today about what happens after you graduate, and suddenly you are adrift in a mentorless sea. Now, when you first cross the causeway for your initial residency here, maybe you're a bit nervous, but it doesn't take you very long to realize that during this program, while you're here, you're relatively safe. After a few days, you embrace this new family you've discovered, and you float around the island from workshop to seminar to reading. The seawall protects you. Subsequent residencies reinforce your feeling of security. Your third semester project may provoke a little anxiety, but the thesis semester is really a blur, and then it's your last residency. And you're excited, and you're prepped for your presentation, and you're ready for your, it was a 20-minute reading when we did it. You're eager to wear the cap and gown in the chapel ceremony, and the fourth semester is so exciting. It's so exciting that you overlook the fact that you have not participated in the mentor selection process. You don't realize it yet, but as a graduate, you are done. Your name did not appear on the blackboard in St. Michael's. You do not have a mentor. This really didn't hit me right away. For a week or so, I was basking in the aura of accomplishment. I had earned my MFA. Then I realized I had no writing schedule to adhere to. I had no page production requirements. I had no packet deadlines. I had no reading list. I had no mentor. I felt as if I had been orphanized, and I don't know if that's even a word, but if it's not, then it should be. Recently, another alum, Kate Gorton, posted on Facebook about experiencing a writing drought. Well, I wasn't having a writing drought. I was having a writing tsunami, And it wasn't that there was nothing. It was that there was too much. My mind was overflowing, and I couldn't find a sight line. I couldn't find a horizon line. I couldn't find any single thing to latch onto. And inside my head, this is what I saw. All of you here on this happy little writer's island, and I was out there in the waves, waving, drifting, further and further away in a mentorless sea, alone. No salad bar, no Crane Lake, just me and my 281 unfinished pages that were trying to drown me. But every word that I wanted, every sentence that I needed to write, it was there, I just couldn't reach it. I was in what I called a washout. And my unfinished novel was haunting me and taunting me, looming up in nightmares, whispering, "You can't do it alone." The torment took different forms. I became obsessed with craft issues. Eugenia's objective correlative was a constant companion. And if I was driving through a construction site, that was my unfinished novel, ripped open by a big yellow backhoe and flanked by orange caution cones. I began to resent it. I read sections of the novel. I turned away in despair. What the heck was I supposed to do with this thing? I devoted 2 years of my life to it, and it wasn't finished. Well, there's a certain type of lunacy that affects many writers, and this often presents itself as absolute logic. And so in my despair, I embraced this logic, and I found my outline for the novel, and I read it twice, and then I did what any self-respecting writer would do. I made it longer. Now, this course of action in reality took me from unlikely to improbable to impossible, but in my mind, if it were longer, then of course it would be impossible to finish, and I would be completely justified in abandoning it. The relief lasted 3 days. And during those 3 days, I figured out a way to let the novel survive. That was probably during those 3 days was when I attended one of the local Fairfield diner dinners that Ben Fine organizes for local MFAers. Kathy was there and talking about duotrope. And I thought, well, what could I send them? I have 281 unfinished pages of a novel that I can't seem to even find one single little short story in that works. So I switched genres and I wrote poetry. And not only did I write poetry, I submitted poetry. And this sounds really crazy, but the whole time I was in the program, I really didn't think about submitting anything. That was a big mistake, really. All of you, submit something. Keep submitting a lot of things. But anyway, I paid my $50 and I joined Duotrope. And I was fascinated by it. Over the course of a week, I sent out maybe 9 or 10 submission packets. Out of those, I got 7 acceptances in little journals, print and online. That felt pretty good. It felt like validation, and basically it kept me going, and it provided enough stimulus for me to actually revisit the novel and start working on it again. And as I said, looking back, I should have begun submitting work while I was still here in the program. So maybe this will push a few of you to get that going right now. Other things that I did to keep myself from throwing the novel through the shredder was I created deadlines for myself, and I think Colin talked about this with workshops. You can attend conferences and workshops that will impose deadlines for you for a specific number of pages. I don't know if anybody else around here writes long, but if they tell me 18 pages, I'll write 30. So just signing up for a conference or a workshop, I'll end up with a good 30, 40 pages of stuff. Might not all be good, but it's there. A group of MFA alumni have put together a writers' conference in Ridgefield. I submitted 20 pages for that. I ended up with a revised chapter of 18 pages. Then last summer, this MFA program instituted its summer writers' conference. I think I was the first one to sign up. But it was another deadline, another workshop, another chapter. And you know, then I did Ridgefield again in the fall, so that's part of my strategy. I just have to keep going to discipline things because I myself don't have very much discipline. It's good to maintain a writing group. I have two writing groups. One is a local group of alumni, and we've been working together for a long time, so we're familiar with each other's work. I also have an alum email partner, so when one thing falls apart, I've still got something going on the other side. And as Colin said, when you're working with other writers, whether you know them well or not, pay close attention to their work, because you're going to learn a lot of things about your own work while you do that. As Kathy said, read a variety of literary journals, print and online, see what's being published, see where your work might fit in. Figure out which journals you respect and where you'd like your work to appear. A decent publication lasts forever. A bad one never goes away. If you can go to AWP, definitely do it. They'll give you tote bags. You can browse the exhibition halls, and they'll give you free samples, and you'll come home with a couple of years worth of reading material. It's really a good thing to do. Kathy talked about submission fees covering subscription costs. I consider that an investment. I think it's a good idea. Okay. Generosity. I don't know if it's true for all MFA programs, because I've only gone to this one, but this one has a really generous spirit. I don't know how many of you are really active on our Facebook page, but for me, it's a regular source of information and inspiration. Recently, Ayana posted a link to an essay she wrote about taking walks with her baby daughter. Now, naturally, when she was walking Joni around, she was pushing a stroller. So, you know, we often get a lot of advice about get outside and commune with nature and this and that. And she had done this before, and a lot of us do this and we're running. It makes a big difference when you're walking, because you can notice things. Ayana pointed out the value of noticing the shape of a leaf, the color of the sky, the way a leaf can drift down from a branch and how it lands on a lawn or skitters across asphalt. If you take out your earbuds and listen to the sounds around you, you'll hear children babbling, wheels crunching, and leaves falling, and squirrels chattering, and all kinds of things that you really don't know are going on. But these details you can keep and use later in your writing. They can really help a scene to come alive. Okay, then opportunities. I don't know if any of you know Alina Dillon. I don't know her either. She graduated before me, or perhaps just after I began the program, but recently Alina had a post out on Facebook. This was in late November. I had read her collection of essays entitled, I Thought We Agreed to Pee in the Ocean. And it was fabulous, and it made me laugh, so I liked Alina even though I didn't know her. But she had a post up on Facebook, and she was a little bit panicked because her agent had returned her novel and asked her to increase the tension. And she really thought she was too close to the work to be able to do that. So she was asking for readers. And I thought, I need tension too, so maybe I'll do that. It was Thanksgiving, I wasn't cooking, I had a lot of time. She sent me the manuscript, I read it in 2 days, and sent her back comments. And we went back and forth for a bit, you know, discussing sections where she could really easily crank things up. For me, it was a trifecta win-win-win. I got to read a great book. I got to make a new writer friend, and she promised that when I'm done with my novel, she'll read it. So what could be better? And these opportunities exist right within this program, even with people that you don't know. So don't be afraid of the people you don't know. Within this group, really, you can't lose. Okay, then I'll talk just a little bit about encouragement. Okay, so George Ryder isn't an MFA-er, but his daughter Jenny is. And at the age of 80, George has a book coming out, The Rogue's Road to Retirement. And it's just incredibly encouraging to witness Jenny's dad's success at an advanced age. And it also gives me hope, because even if it takes me 20 more years to finish my novel, I know it's possible.
It's possible.
Let's see, I have a couple more things. During the time that you're in this program, it's only 2 years. If you take a semester off, it's 2.5. You know, usually you're going to complete it within 3. But that doesn't mean that nothing else is going to happen in your life during that time. A lot of crappy stuff can happen to you. And you can have lousy experiences and derailing moments, and you're frustrated and disappointed and you're sad and you're betrayed and you have experienced tragedies, and you know, all these things really can derail you, and they can make you just, you know, go sit in a closet and shut the door and never write another word. But if you use it, even if you don't use it on something you're writing today, even if you never show it to anybody, even if you just write it down, write things down and don't look at them and keep them somewhere in your desk where nobody's ever going to find them, someday that stuff will be really valuable to you. And last but not least, if you have, when you've done everything you can do and you still can't manage to put it together in a cohesive fashion, I realized during last summer's Writers' Conference that the old adage is true. There is no place like home. And as you, all of you, have no doubt seen from reading workshop submissions, home can sometimes be a pretty dangerous place. But Enders and this MFA family isn't like that. It's really supportive and encouraging, and so my answer was right in front of me. I needed a professional ass kicker, and I knew where to find one. After graduation, if you wait 2 years after graduation, you have the option of working again with a mentor of your choice. You can arrange this through Michael. And amazingly, the price for this is the only thing in the world that has fallen lately. So it's kind of a really good deal. And so next summer, I will again have a mentor. And I'm very excited about that. And the last thing I want to say is just keep in touch. Hopefully by next summer, a couple of us are working on an additional online option that maybe we can all get in on. The name of the website is going to be www.afterenders.com, and we envision it as a sort of 24-hour hotline for writers in panic mode. So we're still working out the details, but it'll happen, and I hope that I'll see all of you there. And that's it for me.
All right. My name is Steve Otfanowski. I'm a member of the first cohort, which graduated in, I guess, January 2011. To talk about my life after the MFA, I have to talk about my life a little bit during the MFA because it leads into it, so I'll do that. We all came to the MFA from different journeys, different life experiences, and mine was different from most people. I was a published writer. I'd written over 140 books, mostly YA books, school library books. Most of them were nonfiction, history, biography, books about states and countries, things like that. Also wrote some fiction, not a lot, not terribly good, you know, Hardy Boy type books, and not very good Hardy Boy books. But what happened during the time I was here was interesting, because while I was learning all this wonderful craft about writing fiction for adults, which is what I wanted to do, the work I was doing as a writer was falling away. The publishing industry was changing. It was becoming more based on internets and software and less on hardcover books. And one of my publishers I've written many books for stopped publishing entirely, went out of business. Another one basically didn't publish books anymore, did most stuff with software. So I was losing a lot of work. That was good in a way, because it allowed me to do more. My 20 pages a month was easy to write. I could work on my third semester project, spend a lot of time on that, finish my novel in the program. But the downside was that I wasn't making very much money, so my income was falling off. And what saved me when the program was over, and what my experience has been in the last 3.5 years or so, is teaching. And I suppose I should have been part of the other workshop earlier today to talk about that. But two things happened in the program that really inspired me and made me want to teach. One was being part of the workshop critiques here on the island, reading the manuscripts of my fellow writers and learning how to make good comments and learning how to be a better writer through seeing the mistakes they make, knowing I made the same mistakes, and maybe helping them with my comments. And I really took it seriously. I think I got a lot out of it for myself, as well as hopefully helping each other as we wrote these comments. I learned a lot from the mentors who ran the programs. I thought they did a great job for the most part. I learned what it is to be a good workshop leader, how to encourage people and how to work with them. I also learned from a couple people, and I won't mention names, maybe not the best way not to do it, to let people dominate a conversation, who obviously have the same thing to say over and over again. I mean, I wanted to see more discipline at times in a couple instances, and I thought, well, if I was running this workshop, I would run a little bit differently. I would be a little tougher on people. I would try to encourage everyone to speak. I would do things a little differently, and that was stimulating to me. And so I learned, and I learned what to do, maybe a little bit of what not to do. So when the program ended, the other thing that helped me a lot, besides the workshop seminars and critiques, was working on my third semester project. Fortunately, I had Bill Patrick as my mentor, which was a good thing and also a very hard thing. I decided to, as I think a lot of us should do, step outside our comfort zone and do something we never did before. I mean, I've written long papers before, critical papers. I didn't want to do that. I didn't necessarily want to teach at that point, at that moment in my life. So I decided to write a screenplay, something I'd never done before. I'd written many plays, I'd written stories and a few novels, but I never wrote a screenplay. Now, this would be a great challenge. So I decided to take one of my novels, my first novel, which is a horror story about a witch, and turn it into a screenplay. I thought, what a great idea. So I said to Bill, this is a great story, and this witch comes out of a weather vane, and she's imprisoned in it for over 300 years, and finally lightning hits it at the end of the book, and she comes out of the weather vane, becomes starts doing terrible things, and then of course she dies. But he said, well, you know, Steve, in a film that's not going to work because you're going to have this visual of this weather vane, and no one's going to be frightened by it. And it's not going to work. I said, well, Bill, that's my whole novel. How am I going to do this? So he forced me to start thinking outside that little box and create a whole new story based on basically the same plot elements, but changing it entirely to make it work as a film. And I had a lot of fun doing that. It was one of the best writing experiences I've ever had in my life. And even though it was frustrating at times, I had a lot of fun. And I realized how a screenplay, different from even a play, you use dialogue, but you also have to have images, and images have to tell the story. The visuals and sound and things like that. And it was so different from what I'd done before. And I just took to it like a fish to water. I really enjoyed it. And even though the screenplay has not been published or has been sold to anybody, I still plan to do something with it. And it was a lot of fun to write it. So, and it also gave me a chance to learn something I could teach, which was screenwriting. And one of my first teaching jobs outside of graduating the program was going to Yale for a summer program called the Summer Institute for the Gifted, SIG. And I recommend, if you're looking for a summer teaching job, it's a wonderful place. They deal with students from all around the world, come there, pay a lot of money to stay at Yale, live in a residency there in one of the residential colleges, and you come in during the day and you teach these kind of sexy classes on things like myth and legend and creative writing and different things like that. So I got to teach screenwriting on my very first time doing it. I've done 4 summers there now, 6 weeks. And it's been a lot of fun. So those are the two things that kind of led me to point me in the direction of teaching. Doing the final presentation here was a lot of fun, and Karen Osborne was my mentor for that and encouraged me to do more with it. So I couldn't get a job doing what I've done here. What I'm doing at Fairfield now, there was no adjunct jobs available. I tried desperately to get a job as an adjunct, and it just didn't happen. I had a terminal degree like we all did, and that's your foot in the door, but then there are a lot of other people sticking their foot in that door, and it's very hard to get past it. So what I did was I decided to substitute teach in my hometown, which is Stratford, Connecticut. And that was a trip. If you've ever substitute taught in public schools, it's just unbelievable. I taught everything from pre-kindergarten through high school. And every day was a different challenge. It was a different adventure. And even though I enjoyed it, I wouldn't want to do it again. I'm glad I could move on from there. But it gave me some sense of what it's like to be in the classroom on a daily basis. And working with students, obviously younger students, high school and under, just like the summer program at Yale was high school students, gifted students. So from there, what did I do after that? I basically started doing some continuing ed. I went to my hometown. They have a continuing ed program at night. So I was able to teach adults. Now, you'd think teaching adults would not be as interesting as teaching, well, we're all adult, but teaching people who are obviously invested in an MFA program or who were in college or something like that. I found some of the writers I encountered in continuing ed were actually some of the best writers I've worked with. They were excellent. They came from all different backgrounds, bankers, lawyers, whatever. Some of them were very gifted writers, and we had a lot of fun. They were very committed to meeting once a week, and the pay is very low to be a continuing ed teacher, but it's a great way to get started in teaching if you come out of this program and you're looking for a way to get your foot in the door and get something on your resume. And I still do it to this day. One day a week I teach in Stratford at a continuing ed, and I've taught fiction, I've taught playwriting, I've taught screenwriting doing that. Finally, like Brian, I got into the core writing program here at Fairfield, we were the first group that got in. There were five of us. And I've been there now for 3 years, and it's been a wonderful experience working with freshmen, composition EN11, EN12, which you heard about earlier. I won't go into great detail. But what I find interesting is, again, none of the students I have, with maybe one or two exceptions, have been English majors. They've all been from different disciplines: nursing, engineering, business administration, business marketing. But you entice them with this creative writing and writing and composition, and some of them turn out to be some of the best writers I've seen. Some of my nursing students turn out to be fabulous writers. We had Bill there last year to come and speak to them, and that was inspirational. So the first semester we teach basically nonfiction essays. Second semester we get into literature, which is a lot of fun. We deal with short stories, poetry, and plays. And again, those of us that are interested in drama, we do more with that. Others that are interested in poetry, do more with poetry. So it's really quite flexible. And again, I encourage any of you who are interested in teaching, and there are people that aren't, have no interest in it or have no aptitude for it. But if you are, I think it's a wonderful experience to get into that core writing and start teaching. I've been blessed to be able to teach fiction workshop, and also hopefully this semester playwriting. I get a few more students. So that's been a great thing. So I've just been blessed with that. My writing is falling off a bit. I haven't really finished a fourth novel. I still haven't sold the third one yet, which I developed here. But I've been writing plays again, and I've had some success with that. I had a show done at Fairfield U last semester, which was a great experience. So I think for me, coming out of this, losing my freelance writing to a certain extent, although I still do that too, I was able to discover what a great experience having as a teacher, and especially a teacher of creative writing and writing in general. And that's been really a great thing for me to do. And I encourage any of you to follow that path. It's certainly, you know, as a co-thing to do with writing. I think it does stimulate your imagination, stimulates your ability to write, and you feed off other writers. I mean, you have a good writer in your class, and you just love to see an essay that's well written, or a critical essay that really gets to the heart of it. And you discover, you know, good writing, and it's almost like being an editor and finding a writer that you're going to publish. We do have an anthology that we publish in core writing, and we take some of the best essays and put it into that, so students get a chance to see their writing in print. And then other students get to look at it as models. So it's really a great experience. That's basically what I have to say. And we look forward to hearing questions from you guys, too. So thank you. There they are. Brian has them right there.
I brought these, yeah. So hi, guys. I'm Brian Hoover. I graduated in the winter of 2012 with Kathy, right?
Yes.
And then Steve and I, as Steve said, we're part of the first cohort of the postgraduate teacher training option that I believe Kristen and Colin and Chris Madden spoke about earlier today. And I wish I could have been here on the island in time to hear some of that, because you know, what I was going to talk about today was essentially my experience balancing the writing and teaching life 3 years into my collegiate teaching career, I guess. I've been teaching at Fairfield University, undergraduate core writing program with Steve for, this is...
3.5 years, huh?
2.5, right?
Two and
but
half?
Yeah, it's...
Seems like longer.
Yeah, it seems like longer, doesn't it? you know, I come to the classroom with one pedagogical tenet that I absolutely swear by up and down, and I've come to this panel in the same spirit. And the way I conduct business in my classroom, and this is, you know, I say a lot of things, but this is the one that I really, really believe, is that everybody in the classroom is a learner, and everybody in the classroom is a teacher. And and so I come today here to, you know, to this panel with my experiences, but not with any what I would call expertise that people in this room, you know, that would put me above anybody in this room as far as what I can offer to this conversation. And so one of the things that I wanted to do, see, I think that teaching works best when it's a conversation, and I think that anything that I was going to say, it's all intertwined with everything that Kathy and Jillian and Steve have already said. And so what I wanted to do was to see, you know, we're nearing the end of the time, and I thought that, you know, some of the things that I've got my points prepared. I've got things that, you know, I can say and speak about. But the conversations that I've had with Baron, and the conversations that I've had with Kathy and Steve in the 2 hours I've been on the island are already more interesting to me than anything that I was going to say, anything that I prepared. Honestly, I'm not even joking. And so one of the things that I wanted to do was just sort of open it up, and I guess this would sort of be the time to start having a little bit of back and forth about some of the things that have been said already, and some of the things that we all must do, especially those of us who are, approaching this dual life, these dual callings of teaching and writing, these things that go so well together but can really strangle each other too at times. And I think that's sort of the place that I'm constantly grappling with, and many people in the room might be as well. And I don't mean to exclude people who aren't teachers, who are not teachers. We all have professional obligations, we all have familial obligations, we all have personal obligations. And so I want to incorporate, everybody's insights into, the conversation that we have for the rest of the time that we're together here. How many people in the room, just by show of hands, are teachers or who have been involved in teaching? Okay, interesting, all right. How many people have been interested in getting into teaching, and how many people in the room? All right, that's interesting to know too. How many people come to the MFA having the goal of teaching in mind, ultimately? Okay, so there are people here who have done it, who have thought about doing it, who want to do it, who aspire to do it, and that's all very interesting. I'm here to speak of, I guess, about some of the things that I have found that have buoyed me in the classroom, and some of the ways that classroom involvement and being devoted to something as as rigorous as teaching, being devoted to something that carries as much responsibility as teaching, how to balance those things. So I made a list of pros and cons, and I guess I'll just start talking about some of them. And if anybody else has insights to offer, to bounce off of these things, I invite the rest of the panel to speak to these things as well. So the things that I think, make me, give me energy as a writer when I'm teaching writing. One of the things that I think, just from a nuts and bolts perspective, I don't get a lot of time, I don't have a lot of time to write as a teacher. When I'm teaching, I start September with a really good head of steam, and I'm feeling really excited, and I'm anxious to meet my new students. And I've got these ideas that are sort of turning in my head, things that I've been working on in the summertime. As Kathy could probably tell you, September is also when a lot of the journals come back on, into their reading periods. They might take the summer off, but September is, hey, Gettysburg Review is back and reading again. I'm going to send something to Gettysburg Review. Okay, so I have all these great, high hopes, I guess, for the for what I can do as a writer as I'm starting to teach. And then you start to assign things, and you start to receive papers back from your students, and then all of a sudden you've got this stack of papers. It's like, okay, so I will put my ass in the chair for an hour on Wednesday when I don't have office hours, and I will do that, and that will be my writing day. I will do my writing things on Wednesday. I will either write, or I will submit, or I will manage my submission logs, and I will finish the final edits on that, or something like that. That'll be my thing that I do on Wednesday, and nothing will ever disturb the thing that I do on Wednesday. That's my time as a writer. Until about October 1st. October comes around, and you've had to respond to major drafts of a major personal narrative that some of us like to assign in English 11. And that's where the real teaching, happens. I think that, as a teacher of writing, I love to teach process. I really love to get into process with my students. And I think one of the things that we've all benefited from as students at this level, the MFA level, you get so much from what your mentor has to say to you on a draft, on an early draft and that sort of thing. And so, October 1st comes around, and you're starting to pour yourself into, responding, teaching, the art of thinking, and teaching the art of writing, and everything like that, and teaching better reading practices and all these things. And so that's great, but that really makes it kind of hard to maintain that time on Wednesday. So like that block, that whole Wednesday morning that you're planning to do your writerly work, maybe you have to just you know, see what you can get done on Wednesday night, because you really need Wednesday to, you know, to grade and plan and stuff like that. And so, you know, so little by little, you know, you start to sacrifice. You start to sacrifice the time that you have set aside for yourself. And I'm saying you, but I'm really talking about myself. So I don't know. You know, that's sort of where I this is my central struggle, people. This is my central struggle. And I have no answers necessarily. Ben Fine, you know, this is a man who we should talk to. I trade plays with Ben Fine. But you know, I think that you know, it's striking the balance that is, you know, the key, the crux, you know, of doing this. How to make sure that one of these endeavors, writing or teaching, especially teaching writing, to make sure that, you know, the teaching doesn't swallow the writing. That's the thing that I think I have to deal with personally the most. Show of hands in the room, teachers, people who have taught, people who have, you know, attempted to do both of these things together. What's the first thing that gets sacrificed in your practice when you're faced with the mounting responsibilities?
Sleep.
Fascinating. True. I mean, it's true. My sleep is eaten into by the grading, usually.
Exercise,
yes. The mind and body connection. Jana's piece that Jillian was talking about the importance of walking was a revelation for me when I read that, because she's dead on it, and she's right there with Thoreau and all those, you know, the Rambler tradition. What else?
Friends.
Friendships. Relationships, yeah, absolutely. We can laugh about that, but that's damn serious right there. What else?
A clean house.
You know what, though? Kudos to the people who can sacrifice these things, because I think that, like, in the midst of, you know, trying to get yourself into the frame of mind where you can sit and engage the machinery, the mental machinery of writing, I think a lot of those things start to take precedence over writing. A lot of the time it can really be, you know, I can say, well, you know, I need my friends. I haven't seen anybody in 2 months. I need to, like, you know, go have a beer with my old roommate or something like that. Mm-hmm. Or, you know what? The bathroom really needs to be cleaned right now. And it needs to be cleaned a lot more than I need to do edits on, you know, that thing.
There's one thing, Brian, that this is for the people who are teaching. I've been teaching a long time, at least 40 years, and the fact is that I don't know if Michael and Baron agree with me, Bill, it gets easier. I mean, after a while, you know what you're doing.
Sure.
And you can still be...
That's a big statement.
20 years.
No, you don't necessarily get better,
what you're doing.
But you know what you want to do. And you can get by it without without that much preparation. I hate to say
yeah.
this, but...
Yeah, but you still have to grade papers, Ryan, unfortunately. Ryan, that's the hard part.
Rachel,
let's talk about what you teach, which is different from what you...
Well, I talked to Ben about this before the panel. I was actually curious to know if it was different because...
You're not reading 100, 200, 300 pages.
No. You're correct, but...
what do you...
No, but I think it's valuable. I think that that's a good point, and I asked Ben about that.
It's time, you know, and if you really want to do a good job, you really
have to
read
thoroughly.
Oh, of course. And it's just a time thing.
Mm-hmm.
What do you teach?
Mathematics.
Oh, well, that's a walk in the park.
But he's writing, like, he's turning out, like, 2 textbooks a year. I mean, it's right.
Well, he has the time for it.
He's not reading literacy narratives, right? So,
that's right.
You know, it's and I'm up here, and I'm sort of trying to be as honest as I can with everybody. I'm not trying to say that there aren't amazing things about teaching that really do feed, you know, what I'm trying to do in my own writing practice. You know, I get to read amazing stuff all the time in terms of the things that I'm, you know, assigning as readings for my students. As Steve said, you know, the first course that we tend to teach in the sequence of the core writing sequence of classes It's a composition and rhetoric class, and it's all essays, and we can go back as far as, Plato, I guess. That wouldn't be called an essay necessarily, but we can go back as far, you know, as the philosophical teachings of the Academy 2,500 years ago, and we can talk about, the essay as it exists today. I get to teach really exciting things that really, you know, help me as a thinker and help me, as a learner and a reader and everything. Even more so in 12, when we get to the introduction to literature, the sort of more traditional intro to lit class, I'm constantly surrounded by amazing writing, and that's incredible. You know, it being a teacher, I think, forces me into a certain frame of mind where I'm thinking about thinking and thinking about reading and thinking about writing and doing all of these things at a much higher level than I would be if I weren't teaching. If I were just I don't mean to say that any other calling is subordinate to teaching. I don't mean that at all. But if I weren't teaching, I don't think I'd be engaging my mind in those ways that are very helpful for a writer to be engaging his or her mind. Mm-hmm. Concrete thing that I love to do. I've been told that I'm very, intellectually honest. In my classroom, and this is, I guess this goes along with my belief that everybody's a teacher and everybody's a learner. Whenever I assign a writing prompt in class, I do it too. And sometimes that's the only writing I get done, you know, in a 3-week stretch, 4-week stretch, 5-week stretch, 6-month stretch, you know. But it's important to me to let my students know that I'm not going to make them do anything as writers that I wouldn't do myself. And I get something out of that. I mean, I've gotten, lots of good things done. It's just good exercise, you know. That's the writer's version of going to the gym, I guess. And you need to do those things, and sometimes teaching, that's the best you can do. And I think that, I get a lot out of doing that. And then there's the thrill of seeing, really exciting student work too. I mean, that's something that that can't be, understated. When you see that hint of promise in a student, and I'm looking at, predominantly first year writers. I'm not looking at, English majors, as Steve said. We get a lot. Everybody at the university takes the course that we take. I guess you can place out of EN11 if you have taken AP English in your senior year of high school, but nobody escapes, the core writing sequence, at least, part of it. Everybody has to do it. So we get engineers, we get nursing majors, we get business majors, we get people who are undeclared, people who've never thought about their future, people who've never thought about books. We get all types. But mm-hmm. still, there's this amazing thing that happens when you see a student who is engaging their mind on the page in a sophisticated way, and it's like, oh, here's a chance to talk craft with a student, and here's a chance to, to do that whole, Dead Poet Society thing where you stand on the desks and stuff like that. That's the dream, right? And so you can have those moments. You can have those little flashes that really, can propel you and energize you and get you to think about your own work in a certain way. I just have to share this phrase that I wrote, that I noticed that I wrote on my page. Yeah, I'm not really referring to my notes a whole lot, but I did come up with this that I think is worth sharing. So whether it was a student who wrote sophisticatedly enough that I could share some dork-ass editorial advice on how to decide whether to use a semicolon or a dash, or a student who seemed to comprehend and practice good revision strategies, these are the types of things that you really live for as a teacher. I'm not joking. So the cons, I don't think I need to talk too much about the cons. The paper pile is a big, a big point of contention. You have to think really clearly about, what you're saying, what you're writing to these students, in creating assignments. What I think is attending to detail and being clear, and what an 18-year-old thinks is attending the detail and being clear are two vastly different things. I've learned that, so it's made me, hyper aware of that sort of thing. Teacherly impulses to instruct and nurture, and, you know, having these things precluding all other work impulses. This is the thing I think that is really, it really all boils down to. I was chatting with Baron at the beginning of the afternoon about some acting advice. I come to writing from the theater, and I come to teaching from the theater and teaching acting. And one of the things that a director of mine once told me as an actor, you know, is to do 100% of one thing. That's like the most amazing advice, really, I think I've ever heard about, you know, what it means to attend to something, to give something your attention and to focus. And I think that the teacher writer question, the crux of that whole issue is it better to do 100% of one thing or to try to do fractions of several things? And to try to understand what's even possible. And so it's all about trying to answer that question for yourself, you know, seeing how much you can be content with being a writer who teaches or a teacher who writes, and you know, what the balance of that is going to be.
64,000.
Yeah, isn't it? So anyway, that's really, you know, as much as I can say, as much as I'll you know, monologue at you folks. I really think this works better as a conversation. So, I mean, we've got time, and this is like the Q&A, I guess, portion of the afternoon. So, who out there has questions, comments, anything?
Could I say something?
Please.
No. Of course. Since this is supposed to be about post-MFA, I graduated when?
13.
In 13, and I was lucky enough to have Bill in two workshops. And Bill always told us stay away from cliches, but I'm going to give you some cliches. And you can say that the one thing is when we started college, all of us went to college. Some of our parents came along, and our parents always go, "Well, what is he going to do in college? You know, what is he going to work at when he gets out?" And I get the same thing. I'm a professor of mathematics. People come to me, "What is little John going to do when he finishes? Why doesn't he do accounting?" And I always tell them, and I'll get to the point of this in a moment, I say, you have to study mathematics because you like it. You'll figure out what you're going to do with it later. There's a lot of things to do. You'll figure out how to do with it later. I come to the MFA, and my parents were long since dead, so they didn't bring me here. But I asked myself, what the hell am I doing this for? And it's a little different if you're 25 or whatever and doing it. But I've come to the realization 4 years later that my dream of being Frank McCord is probably put on hold. But you have to do this because you enjoy it. And you keep doing it because you enjoy it. I mean, people who know me know that in American English, I'm a bullshitter. But that's American English. I don't know what they call that in South Africa.
Bullshitter.
But
bullshitter.
The fact is, you have to love to write poems. You have to love to tell stories. And you know, maybe it's tough. It's tough publishing. We all know that. We sit there and we cry in the diner. But the point is you have to keep going because you enjoy it. I know it's a cliche, but that's what keeps me going. I'm still writing a lot of mathematics. But the fact is, you keep doing it. I'm on Brian all the time. Write, write, write.
It is. Yeah,
now,
I see enough.
Teaching does keep you writing. Because I'm a believer you can't be a scholar without, we can't be a teacher without being a scholar, and you can't be a scholar without being a teacher. I know that's another cliche that Bill will jump on me for, but it's true. It's true. If you're a mathematician, you have to teach mathematics too. If you're a writer, you have to somehow explain your writing to other people. But you have to have your enthusiasm, and you have to love it. And that's sort of my cliche things for post-MFA. You keep going, whether it pans out or not. Because we're doing this because we love it. So,
bottom line. Any other questions? Anybody?
I don't know. Brian, did you have teaching experience before you got your MFA and got your teaching job at Fairfield?
I did, in fact. I had a lot of very diverse, bizarre teaching experience.
Oh, you taught theater.
I taught acting classes to, I worked with actors one-to-one in audition prep type situations. And I also taught acting classes in conjunction with a sort of theater, musical theater workshop. I taught 7 to 17-year-old actors. Not for me. I also taught long-term substitute at the high school level, English and theater. And I also worked, I spent 9 years working with autistic spectrum kids in a behavioral therapy capacity. So I had a lot of very, a lot of diverse teaching experiences, but nothing like teaching writing in the college classroom. So I was really, you know, grateful for the opportunity to go and immerse myself in pedagogy and that sort of thing, you know, through the postgraduate teaching option here. It's been really, you know, I wouldn't have felt confident in my abilities to teach at the college level without that. And certainly, I recommend it to anybody who's interested. Michael, yeah?
I want to thank all of you for doing that. I just wanted to comment on some of the things that Kathy was talking about in terms of submission. I was an editor for about 20 years for literary magazines, and I saw all sorts of stuff coming in. And the one thing I'd say is, when your stuff is ready, send it out. So if you have somebody here that says it's really strong, it's polished, it's a good chapter, even if it's a chapter of a memoir or a novel and self-contained, if they tell you to send it out, start sending it out. Okay, don't send it out before it's ready. Okay. The second thing I'd say is to know the field that's out there, and that's why it's a good thing. I think you mentioned some good books, and most of our faculty are suggesting those books, International Directory, Poets and Writers. You should be aware of those kinds of things. Even if you're writing longer things like memoirs and novels, you can often chop off a section, a chapter, and send it out. It's great to do that, okay? Mm-hmm. Also, it is changing, and Kathy was saying that there are a lot of online, you know, if you went back 30, 40 years ago, we'd have a different conversation here about journals and magazines. I mean, 30 years ago, there were 20, 30, 40, 50 magazines that were published monthly or weekly and paid money. You know, there's very few of those now, and so what has taken up the slack are literary magazines and online magazines. Mm-hmm. So get your stuff out. I get between 5 and 20 magazine calls for submissions a week. I send them to John, he sends them out to you. Don't just, you know, cut those off. Save those. If you have something that's ready, send it out. Mm-hmm. Keep a record, as Kathy was saying, of where you sent it, when you sent it. If it goes for 6 months, send them a little note, okay? And also, simultaneous submissions. I mean, that is the way to go. I've been on panels where they've argued against that. I'm a strong supporter of simultaneous submissions, as long as you're fair and there's rule. I'd be glad to talk to you individually about rules, etiquette, ethics, and so on. But simultaneous submissions, I went from about 6 publications to about 38 publications over a period of print publications over 3 years by simultaneously submitting, changing from one submission at a time. And I did that because I had stories that sat on a desk for 15 months. Mm-hmm. Okay, mm-hmm. I had stories that were accepted, and then later the magazine bankrupt and never came out. Okay, so I'd be glad to talk more about that. If there are more questions, we still have a few minutes before 5.
5 minutes.
Well, thank you guys.